A burden strapped to tie my binds. The fear of waters I have never seen in my dreams. Dressed of courage to face my captors. Give me a rattle to sing my death song. For even if I live, I will taste no more the sweet pumpkin, the roasted corn, and soft beans. I will smell no more the scent of familiar woods and smoked hickory. My greased up hair will shine no more under the rays of a friendly sun. Give me a rattle to sing my death song, because no one will remember my name over the days to come.
Almost like the pieces of a broken puzzle, the history of Native American slavery has, for many years, lied dormant in scattered church records, wills, trade transactions, and footnotes of colonial legislations. This business was initiated by the Spanish just a year after Columbus landed in the Caribbean in 1492. Although it was lost to official versions of history, it was never forgotten by the descendants of the thousands of indigenous men, women, and children that were forcibly made to work for unknown masters in Europe, the Caribbean, and North America. Up until the mid-18th century, every colonial power that competed for the supremacy of North America used indigenous slaves for mines, fields, and construction work. This pre-African slavery experienced by the indigenous Americans at the hands of the French, the English, and the Spanish followed the vagaries of political and economic interests at the core of very different colonial strategies.
If you want to understand the beginnings of Native American slavery, you have to understand the juxtaposition of the three European colonizing strategies in North America. And they were the fur trade in the Northeast, the plantation system in the South, and the Spanish mission system in Florida.
The trade in Indian slaves connected these three colonial strategies. As northern wars for fur hunting territories sent displaced Indian groups to the South, local plantation owners armed them to hunt for slaves amongst the tribes living in the Spanish Florida missions.
One of the most poignant examples of the disruption of Indian slavery on Native groups can be seen through the Apalachee Indians. When the English colony of Carolina developed in 1670, very shortly afterwards, the Apalachee became a primary target for Indian slave raids from Carolina. By 1704, the mission was devastated by these slave raids, and many Apalachee were killed. A vast majority of the remaining Apalachee were sold into slavery in Cuba.
No sign remained of the Appalachians' flourishing culture after the incursions of the English and Indian slave traders. Their temples were burned down, their magnificent council houses were destroyed, and their fields were abandoned. What was once a powerful nation of more than 6,000 people was reduced to a handful of scattered survivors. The trade in slaves proved to be so profitable that Carolina's English and Scottish slavers and their Indian allies pushed themselves deep into Spanish and French territories to hunt for captives. In a letter to Charles Spencer, Earl of Sunderland, written by Thomas Nairn from South Carolina on July 10, 1708, we learn,
"Your lordship may perceive by the map that the garrison of St. Augustine is by this war reduced to the bare walls. Their cattle and Indian towns all consumed either by us in our invasion of that place, or by our Indian subjects, since who, in quest of booty, are now obliged to go down as far on the point of Florida as the firm land will permit. They have drove the Floridians to the islands of the Cape, have brought in and sold many hundreds of them, and daily reduce these barbarians to a far less number. There is not one Indian town betwixt Charlestown and Mabila Bay, except what I pricked in the map. Only am uncertain of the numbers of the Floridians. Our friends, the Talapuis and the Chickasaw, employ themselves in making slaves of such Indians about the lower parts of the Mississippi, as are now subject to the French. The good prices the English traders give them for slaves encourages them to this trade extremely, and some men think that it both serves to lessen their numbers before the French can arm them, and it is a more effectual way of civilizing and instructing than all the efforts used by the French missionaries."
The trade in Indian slaves was a vast enterprise that stretched from as far west as Spanish New Mexico to as far north as the Great Lakes. Virtually every tribe living in this large area was involved in this commerce either as a supplier of captives or as middlemen.
The Caddo traded Lipan Apache, but the Caddo don't really seem to keep slaves. They just kind of trade. It's down the line trade, so to speak. After that, where you have the first count of slaves is more people like from lower Louisiana, the Washaw, the Chawashaw, the Chitimacha, people like that that go into Mobile. By the time they're settled up here and the system is well entrenched in the French trading system, the primary source of slaves is coming from the West.
Many indigenous nations suffered due to enslavement. On the Atlantic seaboard, entire tribes were sold into slavery to the Caribbean.
A compelling example of Indians being sold into slavery in Virginia that's often overlooked is what happened to the Nanzatico people in 1704. That's actually the one instance that we have where a tribe was essentially eliminated as a result of a conflict here. And a small party of those Nanzatico Indians committed a killing of one family, the John Rowley family. But what happened as a result, the Nanzatico were impugned to give up the killers, and they did that. And the killers were convicted in English court, and they were hanged. But the General Assembly also decided that the entire nation could be retaliated against because of what these men had done. So they actually passed a ruling that enslaved the entire population of the Nanzatico, with the exception of children that were under 12, and all of those people were sold into slavery in Antigua, in the West Indies.
Other than being a convenient source of free labor, the enslavement and deportation of Indians to the Caribbean was part of a systematic plan to eliminate the native presence from the emerging colonies.
In the year 1636, was part of that war with the Pequot tribe. The turning point was when over 300 men, women, and children were burned alive and fought at Mystic, Connecticut. The native people that had not been slaughtered were put into slavery, and either in the other tribes who assisted the English in that war, or they were enslaved by the English themselves and sold out of the country in fairly large numbers. And they were sent to various places, and one of the favorite destinations was Bermuda.
Indian slaves were shipped from ports such as Mobile and New Orleans. Whilst the English sent them to Barbados, the French sent them to Martinique and Guadeloupe, and the Dutch sent them to their domains in the Antilles.
Few of us understand that there was also a middle passage from the Americas to the Bahamas, which were the breaking grounds for the slaves, but also to New England, where the markets were. There were some that were sent back to Europe. The very first ones that were sent back to Europe were the property of the king, the queen, and the church. And so, interestingly enough, many of the first Indian slaves were taken back to become, you know, wards of the state and the property of the people there.
Whilst undeniably a minority, dozens, perhaps hundreds of Native Americans crossed the Atlantic, reaching Europe as slaves. A rare proof of this is the case of John Panis, a Native American child whose tombstone is still visible in Kent, England.
We know very little about John Panis, apart from the fact that we have his tombstone in Hayes Churchyard. Now, in 1754, William Pitt had moved to Hayes, and by the end of the decade, he was actually virtually in charge of the government at a time when Britain was having various military successes all over the world. John Panis may have been given as a gift from someone who was pleased with the successes that were being achieved and was brought to England and became a servant in his household, or possibly for his children, because by 1763, William Pitt had five children. A number of people have been suggested as possibly the people that may have given William Pitt John Panis as a gift, perhaps Benjamin Franklin, or possibly General Fore, who captured the fort that has since become known as Pittsburgh. Or he may be one of the wealthy merchants who had connections with the West Indian plantations, where they had slaves. And one candidate is William Beckford, who became Lord Mayor of London, who was very grateful for Pitt's support for him when there was a question that they might put taxes on sugar. We can only imagine what horrendous journey he might have had. The sea voyage, possibly seasickness. It's difficult to imagine how he felt when he arrived in a strange country with different customs, different culture, different language, different clothes. He would have felt very strange, I think. We don't really know why he was buried in Hayes Church, or indeed how he died. He must have succumbed to some illness, or possibly it was winter time, perhaps it was smallpox, or it could have been an epidemic, or some European disease he was not used to. Unfortunately, the burial records for that period do not survive, so we can't tell if there was an epidemic in the area. Of the 650-odd burials that took place in Hayes Church in the 18th century, 15 memorial stones survive. One of those is John Panis's, so he must have been regarded with some consideration to actually have had a headstone erected for him.
Between 1650 and the beginnings of the 18th century, as many as 50,000 Indian slaves had been sold by the English alone to their colonial outposts in the Caribbean. But these numbers are incomplete because many transactions were unrecorded due to the heavy taxation put on slave cargoes. What is more, the fact that slave records almost exclusively mention European names makes it difficult to establish the ethnicity of the people traded.
For the most part, the greatest source of information comes from the Catholic Church records. And they very rarely have even ethnicity, much less a prior name. The names they take are Catholic names. So you have Marianne and Marie Therese and, you know, Jean de la Grande Terre and whomever.
Clearly, there are records that establish that Indians were enslaved as early as the first half of the 17th century, quite more frequently in the second half of the 17th century.
First of all, here in our own territory, if we were made slaves, we had the recourse of running away to our communities, which frequently happened, or to other communities that would give us shelter.
Such was the trouble Indians caused that even colonial outposts such as Barbados called for an end to the deportation of Indians from North America. In 1676, Barbados issued an act that prohibited the importation of Indian slaves.
This act is passed to prevent the bringing of Indian slaves, and as well as to send away and transport those already brought to this island from New England and the adjacent colonies, being thought a people of too subtle, bloody, and dangerous inclination to be and remain here.
Former names were replaced by new ones that gradually left behind a past encoded in elder stories to make room for novel identities. Mixed-race offspring soon became people of color, and Indians gradually disappeared from the records of history.
The English found what they could not accomplish with the torch and the gun, they could accomplish with the stroke of the pen. So that's why they mislabeled our people racially in the records more and more as time went on, until eventually there was no Indian presence in the records. There was never that designation. You were identified as mulatto, musty, or any of those other terms rather than Indian.
Such was the effort to erase Indians from history that up until the early 20th century, scientists of academic institutions deliberately altered census records.
In Virginia, there was a leader of the eugenics movement, a man by the name of Dr. Walter Plecker. He changed records of Virginia Indians that were born and recorded as Indian people to say that they were colored. He did this on birth certificates, marriage certificates, on death certificates, on any legal records that he could get his hands on. So since he physically destroyed or changed records of so many Virginia Indians, he essentially committed an act of bureaucratic genocide on the Virginia Indians. I can't see a more obvious event than what happened in the 20th century in terms of Virginia Indians being written out of history.
Sometimes it got to the point where you were even afraid to say that you were Indian. And you told your children not to because it was safer. And so there were just all these different ways of erasing Native people from the cultural landscapes.
At one point in time, it was a bad thing to even say you were Native American. Some people had to lie on their birth certificates and state that they were either Black or that they were white. So that definitely had an effect on Native American people.
Native people have become the invisible minority here, particularly in the Northeast. The census takers, who were generally white males, made their decision about who was Indian and who was not Indian. And if you did not look Indian, then you didn't get on the census as being Indian. And so those records, whether it was talking about slavery, whether it was talking about indentured servants, you know, it's like putting a 50 million piece puzzle together.
They took parts of us and cut them up and threw them to the winds. They made lies we would believe. We look for the parts to put ourselves back together, to put the earth back together. It is broken. We look for truth to put us all together again. There is a piece here, a part there. We scavenge and collect. Some pieces are lost. We will find them. Some parts are found, and we do not see them yet. We gather the pieces and bring them together. We bring them together. We make the truth about ourselves. We make the truth.
Wow. Hope you guys enjoyed that introduction. Very good documentary. I've shown parts of it in old videos. I never showed the full length documentary, mostly because we have gone over the actual information, not just the video telling us, but the actual sources proving what the video is saying. I want to make sure to invite you guys, if you have not been able to check out one of my series called From Indigenous American to African American. I actually have the playlist in order, but in particular dealing with today's subject, Indian slavery, from parts 12 to 20, I highly recommend you guys go back to them. As you can see here, it says your conquest and enslavement. It's part 12, genocide. Part 14, transatlantic slave trade in reverse. Part 15, the French enslavement of the American Indian, the Courier's Du Bois. Part 16, processes of enslavement, POWs, not ADOs. Part 17, POWs, not ADOs, indentured service. Part 18, the illegal beginning of American Negro slavery. Part 19, 1619, indentured service, they weren't slaves. Part 20, first Negro slaves, Indians in 1526. But these titles actually don't describe what's actually in these videos. A lot of information in these videos to go over. A lot of information proven the documentary we just saw. So you guys can take a look at it very thoroughly, very scholarly sources. This is real. When you start adding up the numbers, you guys will understand that the highest percentage of so-called slaves were already here in the Americas. Now, let's not forget, even though we're not talking about it today, there's also that the other source of so-called slaves was from Europe. Let's not forget that. Highly recommend watching this two videos right here, at least. Indentured over Middle Passage, persecuted in the name of colonization, American dream, part one and two. And we're being sent to the plantations over here as well. Now we're in uncommonwealth.virginiamemory.com. So it's here, the Uncommon Wealth, voices from the Library of Virginia archives. All right. So it's here, hundreds of the descendants of Indians have obtained their freedom. Freedom sues in the 18th and 19th century Virginia. All right, quick article here we're going to read. A small slip of paper on display in the Library of Virginia's latest exhibition, You Have No Right, Law and Justice in Virginia, running 24 September 2012, 18 May 2013, all right, this is a little old, was of immense importance to 12 people. It discloses, even though it does not state the fact in so many words, that on 2 May 1772, they gained their freedom after being held in slavery, since each of them was born. The piece of paper in the fates of those Virginians illuminates a disturbing and little-known part of Virginia's history, the enslavement of American Indians. The paper came into the possession of the Library of Virginia in 1988 when it acquired a copy of Volume 2 of John Tracy Atkins' Reports of Cases Argued and Determined in the High Court of Chancery in the time of Lord Chancellor Hardwicke, London 1765 to 1768, that had once been in the library of the colonial government in Williamsburg. One of the librarians in the cataloging section showed it to me, knowing of my interest in that library. When she lifted it from her desk to hand it to me, a piece of paper that had been slipped between leaves in the middle of the volume fell out and fluttered to the floor. We were surprised, and I was even more surprised when I saw what it was. It was a 1780s or 1790s copy of the judgment in Robin versus Hardaway, or Robin or Hardaway, an unusual important case decided in the General Court of Virginia. The librarian and I presented the judgment to the archivist, who added it to the meager surviving records of the colonial General Court. The court case had two parts. First, attorney argued about whether a 1682 law that allowed for the lifetime enslavement of Indians imported from other colonies had been repealed in 1684, 1691, or 1705. For decades, Virginia's courts had assumed that the 1684 invalidated the 1682 law. And under that persuasion, one of the attorneys informed the court, hundreds of the descendants of Indians have obtained their freedom on actions brought in this court. The court concluded the first part of the case by deciding that the 1682 law had remained in effect until 1705. This decision enlarged the number of residents of Virginia who could not hope to gain their freedom by claiming to be descendants of Indian women illegally enslaved between 1684 and 1705. A jury trial then established that the 12 people were descendants of an Indian woman who had been illegally enslaved. The jury awarded Robin, Hannah, Daniel, Cuffy, Isham, Moses, Peter, Judy, Audrey, Sylvia, Davy, and Ned, all of unstated age, 1 shilling in damages. Each received 1 penny, but each also received freedom. Some excellent 21st century scholarship demonstrated that English-speaking Virginians enslaved many more Indian residents of Virginia in the 17th century than earlier historians believed, all right? It wasn't Africans. Oh, they told us it was Africans, but look what they found when they started actually going into the scholarship, going into the records. Oh, actually, Indians got enslaved more than we actually believed. And that the enslavement may very well take place in spite of the laws or in the absence of laws governing the enslavement of Indians. All right, so again, before we continue, I just want to emphasize all these court cases. We go over this in my videos from Indigenous American to African American, a lot of different examples, and how this was going on in different states and different periods of time. So make sure to go ahead and watch those videos. If you have not, again, highly recommend it. Continuing, it says here, because almost all the records of the colonial general court burned in the fire that destroyed the state courthouse in much of the business district of Richmond in April 1865. Oh, how convenient that this building burned, right? How convenient they burned this building that would prove that all these people are Indian. The specific record of the outcome of the important 1772 freedom suit naming the persons freed is especially rare and valuable. Continuing, we're in the Case Law Access Project, Harvard Law School. We're just talking about Bud versus Rachel. This is from March 5, 1814, Supreme Courts of Appeals of Virginia, Bud versus Rachel and others. All right, so this is the digitized form. We're going to go to a document that I actually has here. All right, and it says here, Bud versus Rachel and others. It says, slaves, American Indians. A Native American Indian brought into Virginia since the year 1691 could not lawfully be held in slavery here. Notwithstanding, such Indian was a slave in the country from which he or she was brought. This was a suit for freedom by the appellees against the appellant in the Superior Court of Law for Norfolk County. At the trial, the defendant tendered a bill of exceptions, which was signed and sealed, stating that the plaintiffs claimed their freedom upon the ground of their being the descendants of Papoose, a Native American female Indian, Papoose, who was brought into Virginia about the year 1747, and moved the court to instruct the jury that no Native American Indian brought into Virginia since the year 1691 could under any circumstance be made a slave. All right, that was law. And then even if they're saying 1705, she was brought 1747, so that was even after 1705, so it's law, they shouldn't be slaves. All right, this was an Indian woman, okay? Which instruction the court did give, whereupon the defendant, who claimed to hold the plaintiff as slaves, upon the ground that, though they were alleged to be descendants of the said Papoose, a Native American Indian, the said Indian was alleged to be a slave and held as such in the island of Jamaica. Okay, so again, when you go over those videos and you go over the My Indian Slavery documentaries, you'll see that American Indians from all over the Americas, not just North America, but were being sent to Jamaica. It was a major hub for Indian slavery, a lot of the sugar plantations. It wasn't Africans they were supplying this with, it was actually American Indians and Black Europeans, the prisoners of war. Remember, the Jacobites were sent to plantations, you know, all this stuff. So you guys got to remember all this. But very interesting here is that they're saying Papoose was being held in Jamaica as a slave. All right, even though she was an American Indian. So she had come in from Jamaica into Virginia in 1747. And her descendants now are fighting for their freedom, saying, hey, she was never so-called African or a slave. She was an American Indian. So by their own laws in Virginia, they could not be held as slaves. So she was held in Jamaica, it says, by the wife of Mr. Ivy and brought by the said Ivy into Virginia as a slave. About the year 1747, moved the court to instruct the jury that a Native American Indian held in Jamaica as a slave under the laws of that island and imported into Virginia by her proprietor in that year 1746 or 1747 might be lawfully held as a slave in Virginia, notwithstanding such person was a Native American Indian, which instruction the court refused to give, to which opinion of the court the defendant accepted. Verdict and judgment for the plaintiffs, from which the defendant appealed. Wickham for the appellant. The only point in this cause arises upon the bill of exemptions, the relevancy of which cannot now be brought in question. The instruction prayed for was that no American Indian brought into this state after the year 1691 could be a slave. The court instructed the jury accordingly, notwithstanding the Indian was brought from Jamaica. This instruction, I contend, was erroneous. The ninth section of the Act of 1805, which was supposed to prevent, by implication, the making any Indian slaves, was only intended to establish free trade with the neighboring Indians. In the second volume of Henning's Statutes at Large are several acts showing that Indians might be slaves, for the persons who could lawfully be held as such are not described as Negroes only, but as any persons not Christians. In the first and second volumes, many laws are found prohibiting and restricting the trade with Indians, in which the words natives, savages, and Indians are indiscriminately used, as meaning the same thing. The scope and intention of the Act of 1691, although in words is established free trade with all Indians whatsoever, was plainly to do away the preceding restraining acts without contemplating foreign Indians, with whom the people of this country had no trade or connection. None of the decisions of this court have any bearing on this case. The only point decided in Jenkins versus Tom and others, first Washington 123, is that in suits for freedom, hearsay evidence concerning ancient transactions is admissible. That cause was lost for want of a regular bill of exemptions to the judge's opinion. In Coleman versus Dick and Pat, EB 233, it was decided that no American Indian could be made a slave in this state since 1705, but that foreign Indians might. Two of the judges conceived the findings of the jury in which it was not said whether Judith was brought in by sea or land was insufficient. The word American in that case is ambiguous and used in its limited sense to mean Indians in that part of America, having intercourse with or neighboring to Virginia. No such word is found in any of the laws. Was not a Peruvian a Carib or native of Hispaniola a foreign Indian? Two of the judges evidently thought it necessary to show that the Indian was brought in by land. The case, instead of being against us, is a direct authority in our favor. In Huggins v. Wright and Pallas v. Hill, the word American is used in the same restricted sense. According to those cases, no Native American Indian brought into Virginia since the year 1691 could be lawfully made a slave. But the Indian Papoose was not made a slave in Virginia, but was in that condition when brought in. Word for the appellees, the instruction given was correct. Since 1691, no Indian could be held in bondage. I do not contend merely that Indians could not be reduced into slavery, but that they could not be held as slaves. This was the plain consequence of free and open trade with all Indians, whatsoever, at all times and in all places. All right, so yeah, so there you go. They wrote that in. They can't make them slaves. It was not conferring any boon upon them, but merely acknowledging the rights which God and nature gave. All the acts before 1691 describe particular Indians such as friendly, neighboring, and other restrictive phrases. But the Act of 1691 uses the words all Indians whatsoever, all Indians, even the ones in Jamaica. Amid Mr. Wickham's construction of the word American, the Indian woman Papoose is declared by the Bill of Exceptions to have been a Native American Indian, carried from this country to Jamaica and brought hither from that island. So you see that? So she was originally from North America. She was originally from North America anyway, so they had to give her freedom. They had to respect that. They were trying to make her a slave. They're like, no, but she was a slave in Jamaica, so it doesn't matter. She wasn't from here. But look at that. She was made a slave here in Virginia, probably because she was sent to Jamaica as a slave, right? As we just heard in the documentary, many Indians were being enslaved, right, and sent to the Caribbean. This is one of them. And she had made her way back to Virginia, right? Now, again, it says here, the Indian woman Papoose is declared by the Bill of Exceptions to have been a Native American Indian, carried from this country to Jamaica and brought hither from that island. We had no right to declare Papoose free in Jamaica, but we had the right to say that when brought into our territory, she should be free. All right. And it's not an African. She's an American Indian from Virginia. We're in the Smithfield Review now, volume 12, 2008. It says here, Indian Slavery and Freedom Suits, the cases of Rachel Vinnie and Rachel Finley. Although we often think of Negro slaves obtaining their freedom under certain circumstances, it is also true that some Indians, what's the difference, right? In Virginia, who were slaves, obtained their freedom. Many of them used the court system in Williamsburg, especially in the 1770s when a multitude of cases were heard, all right? A multitude of cases, many cases, hundreds. The procedures were later spelled out in the Court of Virginia, and freedom suits were mentioned in the files of the Superior Court and local court orders and in decided cases of the Supreme Court. This article tells the story of two women, residents of Southwest Virginia, who obtained their freedom through the local court systems. Rachel Vinnie in 1815 and Rachel Finley in 1820. How could slaves file a lawsuit against their master? What a great question. All right, think about that. I've been saying this many times, right? We know the truth. Why, right? Because they were indentured servants. How could slaves file a lawsuit against their masters, right? If it was all about Kunta Kinte slavery. They're going to admit they don't know, but they're going to suggest a reason. It says here, continuing, in these specific cases, the exact details are missing. They don't know. They don't know how. They don't want to say. They don't want you to think all African slaves, right? They don't want you to know about indentured servitude and contracts. But it is known that Quakers, Methodists, and some local citizens were often willing to give assistance and encouragement. Yeah, who's the Quakers and Methodists? These were black folks too. Yes, let's not forget what we've learned in the previous presentations. If the slave could reach the courthouse, then the laws of Virginia were specific. Persons who believed that they were entitled to be free were permitted to appear before the justice of the court in the country where they lived. So now it was a regular thing. So if you thought you were free, you could just go to court? That doesn't sound like slavery to me. If the court believed there was enough evidence to hear the case, the slave was permitted to file a petition reciting the reasons for the belief. Now, slaves are filing petitions and taking their masters to court. Do you guys see what we're reading? The facts of the case usually show that the individual was descended in the maternal line from an Indian brought into Virginia and held in slavery at a time when such was illegal. Such illegal enslavements of Indians occurred repeatedly. After the case was filed, the master or owner of the slave was required to appear and post bond in an amount double the value of the petitioner. In the meantime, the slave was protected by the sheriff of the county. All court costs and attorney fees were free because the slave was usually without means and considered to be a pauper. All right, so they were even protected by the sheriff. The slaves were being protected from their masters. Does this sound like what they told you in school? I'm being real with you. You got to remember what they told you in school. It's not what they told us in school. Not in my elementary school in Boston. These freedom suits were often referred to as informa pauperius cases. Some were indexed under the word pauper or the first name of the person bringing the suit. Seldom were surnames mentioned, but the two cases that follow are exceptions. The master's bond required that there be no interference and no abuse toward the slave while the evidence was being gathered. And there was to be no prohibition from allowing the summons to be obtained. Yet in at least one instance in Southwest Virginia, the lower court refused to hear a case. Consequently, the attorney filed a right asking to transfer the case to the higher or superior court. This fact emerged from the Finlay lawsuit, where documents filed proclaimed that because a certain relative of the master was a justice on the court, it would be impossible for the case ever to be heard there. In the two specific cases mentioned in this article, one was filed in Montgomery County and the other in Whitty County, Virginia. Each of the petitioners was named Rachel, one with the surname Vinnie, the other Finley. Each had been freed by a court in Eastern Virginia, but since these records have not survived, exact details are unknown. Oh, they don't survive, huh? You burned them, you destroyed them, or you just hide in them? Even though the slaves had obtained their freedom, their masters moved them westward, where they were sold illegally as Negro slaves. Again, who? Remember, these are Indians, and they were sold as what? And illegally selling them as Negro slaves. As a result, the two Rachels had to file freedom suits to try once more to gain their freedom. They had to go to court again. You guys hear that? They already had won their freedom. Rachel Vinnie and 18 other members of her family were from Northumberland County, Virginia. And her first case was held in the District Court for Richmond, Westmoreland, Lancaster, and Northumberland, where they recovered their freedom by verdict dated September 7, 1791. In addition to their freedom, they were awarded 1 shilling in damages. These facts were recited in the case filed in Montgomery County on December 23, 1806, when for the second time Rachel filed for her freedom. The evidence showed that her ancestor was Mary, who had come into Eastern Virginia by ship with her granddaughter Bess. They were identified as Indians, not Africans. Again, I'm going to repeat that because you didn't hear. They were identified as Indians, not Africans. And were described as being of yellow complexion and had long straight hair down to their waist. Bess was a young girl of 12 or 13. No Indian tribe was mentioned. Rachel Vinnie was a child of Sarah, a descendant of these two Indian women. The case stated that she had been sold back into slavery as a Negro. She was purchased by Henry Patton, of a well-known family who lived in that part of Montgomery County that is now Pulaski County. Her petition was filed in March 1807 without fees or cause because she was classified as a pauper. She filed for trespass, assault and battery, and false imprisonment, which was the standard request in such cases. Not only was she suing for her own freedom, but she was also petitioning the court for her children, Hannah, Santi, Jimmy, Abigail, Joe, and Solomon, all of whom were being held illegally by Henry Patton. In addition, she sued for her son Marcus, who was in the possession of Samuel Patton, a son of Henry, and her son Jupiter, who was in the possession of Andrew Johnston of Giles County. Her daughter Hannah's 3 children, Sam, Daniel, and William, were also included in the suit. After more than 8 years in the court system, all were declared to be free in 1815. In 1816, the Giles County list of free persons of color included Rachel Vinnie, age 49, then living in the New River at Phillips Peters Place. Her occupation was listed as spinster, meaning someone who does spinning and weaving. Also in Giles County were Hannah, age 27, Jupiter, age 22, Santi, age 18, Abby, age 14, Joe, age 12, Solomon, age 10, Sam, age 7, Daniel, age 5, Bill, age 3, and Jim, age 4 months. In 1830, Jupiter, Jimmy, and Hannah were still residing in Giles County. The other Rachel, identified as Rachel Finlay, had a similar experience. She was declared to be free the first time in 1773 by the court in Williamsburg. She claimed her descent from her grandmother named Chance from the matrilineal line, who was brought into Virginia by Indian trader Henry Clay of what is now Powhatan County. All right, Indian trader, Indian slave trader. Based on uncertain evidence, Chance was approximately 6 years old and had been kidnapped by Clay somewhere in southern Indian nations. Catawba, Choctaw, and Creek were all mentioned. All right? But when you look at the place, I'm going to tell you guys now, when you understand where she got kidnapped from, when talking about Virginia, We're most likely talking about Catawba, more than Choctaw Creek. Two Indian children, Chance and James, who was about 8 years old, and their progeny were raised by the Clays. The exact date of their arrival in Virginia is not known, and it is not known how soon after their arrival Henry Clay took them to the Henrico Court in August 1712 to have their ages adjudged. At this time, Indian slavery was no longer legal in Virginia, a fact ignored by the Clay family. Rachel Finlay, the granddaughter of Chance, was illegally transferred about 1773 to the frontier of Virginia by Mitchell Clay of Powhatan. She was then 20 years old, and her daughter Judy was 6. They lived in the remote parts of what is now West Virginia, at the place later known as Princeton. The following year, Rachel and Judy were sold as Negro slaves to John Draper, who lived in Draper's Valley, in that part of Whitty County that became Pulaski, all right? So again, and I want you guys to really pay attention to what I'm about to say here, and especially those who are doing genealogy and get confused when they find probates and wills, and when they're saying, oh, I give you to my daughter, you know, my Negro slave, you know, Henrique, you know, whatever name they have. Because as you can see here in this article, they sold Rachel and Judy as Negro slaves to John Draper. So if you would read a probate or a will that included Rachel and Judy as Negro slaves, you would never imagine. Most people would consider automatically that these are African slaves. And that's not the case. This is something very important to look out for. And don't think these are white people who are doing this and selling the people. Again, this is indentured servitude. And they were doing this to American Indians and other unwanted Europeans. They were doing it to their own people. This is what they were doing in Europe before they got here. While with the Drapers, Rachel had 11 children. And although she attempted many times to find someone to help her get to the court 20 miles away in Whitfield, or find an attorney to help her, she did not make the trip until 1813. She was then 60 years old and had 42 descendants, many or all of whom would also be entitled to their freedom if her case succeeded. Okay? The results were not immediate because her evidence had to be gathered in Powhatan County, where the elders of the community knew her and her circumstances. Court papers show that Rachel made at least 2 trips to Powhatan to take depositions for the trial. Eventually, the case was transferred to Powhatan, and in May 1820, after 7 years in the court system, she was once again declared a free person. Do you see how much she had to fight for her freedom? Twice? The second time? Man. She had to fight for all these years just to prove who she was. Not only did Rachel Finley file her case for freedom, but 30 of her 42 descendants can be identified in various lawsuits which followed, okay? So again, you got slaves going to court and suing their masters. Lawsuits. You guys understand? That slavery narrative they gave us in school is all false. Break the spell. In addition, her youngest daughter somehow found her way to Huntsville, Madison County, Alabama, and records there show that she received her freedom based on her mother's successful lawsuit. Other members of Rachel's family were probably given to Draper children who moved west and left no local information. So meaning, they probably never got freed, or they didn't find out they could be freed. They just got taken to the west without knowing what happened. The court order books mentioned those family members of Rachel who had been freed in the local courts. Their freedom was granted based on the fact that their mother or their grandmother, Rachel Finley, had been freed by the court in Powhatan. Later, the same court recognized her success when she filed for registration as a free person of color descended from an Indian named Chance. Rachel Finley's story appeared in the Journal of the Afro-American Historical and Genealogical Society in 2003, even though earlier, right, they admitted she was an African. They're not Africans, but they're being called Afro-Americans, right? They got put in this book. They got tagged. They got grouped into the Afro thing. In addition, court papers filed in Whitty and Powhatan counties were used as a basis of the historical novel Free in Chains, written by this author and published in 2002. Since publication of the novel, the article in the J-A-A-H-G-S, and the book Free People of Color, a descendant of Chance, who traced his heritage to Rachel's daughter Judy, her daughter Anne, and her daughter Melinda, had been identified and is residing in Florida. He has an extended family living in various places in the United States and is very proud of his Indian heritage and the fact that he was able to make the connection to Chance, born about 1706. The reader can only imagine what it must have been like for their two Rachels to know that they had followed the rules, gained their freedom, and then were betrayed and returned to slavery as Negroes. All right, pay attention, guys. This happened many, many times in many, many cases. You're gonna find this in the genealogy. You're gonna hit dead ends and stuff. You're gonna be weird, like, what's going on? Rachel Vinnie spent 24 years in illegal servitude after the first court case in Northumberland. It took the Montgomery County Court more than 8 years of that time to reach his decision. Rachel Finley waited 47 years for her freedom after her case was heard in Williamsburg. 7 of those years were spent waiting for the courts of Whitty and Powhatan counties to act. Dreams of freedom for themselves and their many descendants must have given them patience and determination to win from real situations, real history. It was a struggle. Hope you guys enjoyed this brief presentation. Make sure to catch those Indian slavery videos I did in the past if you haven't. A lot of good information so you can understand what really happened when it talks about these slave narratives and all that. Thanks for tuning in once again. I got a lot of videos coming in the next couple of days. Been very busy helping a lot of people with their genealogy. It's been great. A lot of fun, a lot of discoveries. I'm coming strong with some videos. Gonna have some special guests, bring back Kurimeo meditations. Some great people on the panel so you guys can meet them. Looking forward to that. Look out for those videos as well. Much love and respect. Pura vida, mi gente. Wow.